Well, hello and welcome to the movie special from St. Patrick's Cathedral, Dublin, with the music recorded on our wondrous machine, the cathedral's great Willis organ. I'm Michael Lee, here at a safe distance in my room to say a few words of introduction and hopefully make sense of what you're about to hear. Now, we're in what used to be the summer blockbuster season, that special time when we'd celebrate the return of sunshine by sitting in the dark, watching monsters do battle in outer space. The music department, well, what's left of it, which means our wonderful organist, Mr. Stuart Nicholson, has come up with a program that's all about the movies. And we're going to have some fun and a bit of nostalgia, taking us back to what a few poor delinquents think of as the heyday of the summer blockbuster, the 1980s. So let's drift back to a time when mobile phones were the size of bricks, social distancing was kept up with padded shoulders and big hair, and the worst thing on the horizon was the thought of World War III and a nuclear winter. Great days. Along the way, we can also contribute to an excellent cause with a collection in aid of a special charity. More on that later. Where to begin? The year is 1985. It's time to join Marty McFly in that specially enhanced DeLorean and drive off back to the future. This film began as a hapless labour of love for writer and director Robert Zemeckis until he finally secured studio backing and the presence of the one and only Michael J. Fox, as well as playing music by Huey Lewis, Eric Clapton and Eddie Van Halen. Zemeckis also called on his regular musical collaborator Alan Silvestri to help set the mood. So, settle down and enjoy. The music of Alan Silvestri, from the soundtrack to Back to the Future. What a film. What times. During the movie, Marty McFly, our hero, has to take on different identities to avoid things getting too complicated with members of his own family. We all feel that way sometimes, even without the time travel. Anyway, there's a point when Marty, dressed in a full radiation suit, as you do, appears to the young man who is eventually to become his father. He explains his appearance by introducing himself as, and I quote, Darth Vader, an extraterrestrial from the planet Vulcan. And this, crude connection though it may be, is as good a way as any to segue to the inevitable entry into our program of the biggest blockbuster franchise of them all. And no, not Brideshead Revisited. Who wrote this? A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away, Star Wars, A New Hope, was simply known as Star Wars, and a very entertaining film it was, with a Pulp Fiction plot and a novel line in merchandise. How times have changed. John Williams's music, though, was there from the start, enlivening this never-ending tale of wonder and suspense. Here's music first heard in The Empire Strikes Back. It's Darth Vader's theme music, The Imperial March. You can just feel the tension. I hope you enjoyed that brush with Star Wars. In the world of film music, the name that always comes up, of course, is John Williams, whose music we just heard there. He's 88 years old now and still going strong, an extraordinary career. You think of some of the great films of the 1970s, 1980s, 90s, noughties, 10s. Sure enough, that name just keeps turning up. So it's hard to single out any one of his film scores. We've heard a bit of The Empire Strikes Back, released in 1980, and now we turn to a film made just a couple of years later. E.T., the Extraterrestrial, is just one of many successful collaborations that Williams made with the legendary filmmaker Steven Spielberg. Spielberg, of course, is more than just a filmmaker. He's one of the great American storytellers, the definition of a safe pair of hands as far as the movie business goes. He has that knack for focusing in on the human heart of a storyline. And for this, music plays a vital role. Nowhere is this more true than an E.T., which is, well, what is it? Part science fiction, part ghost story, but mostly a social drama about what it's like growing up in suburbia as our friendly little alien tries to cope with being stranded in this odd place we call home. there's something special about that film, isn't there? Wonderful sense of atmosphere and John Williams's music for E.T. You'd never get away with that in a movie now. Sadly, we are nearing the end of our programme. So it's time, perhaps, for something a little more upbeat. We've had the extraterrestrial, so how about the supernatural? A blockbuster that is intentionally and successfully funny is a rare and wonderful thing. And that's what arrived in the summer of 1984 as Bill Murray, Dan Aykroyd and Harold Ramis joined forces to create everyone's favourite paranormal pest control team. Filmmaker Ivan Reitman felt the film really needed a hit song to get everybody's attention. And thanks to Ray Parker Jr., that's what they got, creating the unforgettable catchphrase. Who you gonna call? Ghostbusters? I've been told that we should listen out for some special effects from the organ loft for this one. And so, there we go. Thank you for viewing this 80s movie special recorded in St. Patrick's Cathedral, Dublin. And we certainly hope you've enjoyed your time with us. Normally, in a live concert situation, I'd cue a big hand to our organist, Stuart Nicholson, at this point. And, well, yes, if you like, you can clap now. Go on. But yes, if you enjoyed this, you might like to consider making a donation to our charity. And wherever you are, whatever you're doing, have a great day and keep well. time for a little more, perhaps, as well as films about people from out of space or out of time, it's still possible for a successful blockbuster to be a bit more down to earth. Maybe that's why the films of Indiana Jones did so well, being about an archaeologist, after all. Such a grubby job. Though, really, of course, these films are about putting a real-life human being, warts and all, into crazy, ridiculous situations. And lots of them. Things just keep happening in these films. They're like a funfair ride. When Steven Spielberg asked John Williams, yes, them again, to find a theme for Dr. Jones, he came up with not one, but two of them. And Spielberg liked both. So the composer just mixed them together. And that became the Raiders March, that big tune you'll hear shortly. Three Indiana Jones were released in the 1980s. They're the only ones to watch. And we've music from all three.